All right. Hello, everybody. Welcome. Thank you for joining us. My name is Denise Augusto, and I'm the director of the Master's in Science in Information at Drexel University's College of Computing and Informatics. I'm very honored today to have a guest with us here. She is Kiera O'Shea Vargas, the founder of Epiphany, a consulting company that she will tell you a little bit about. I'm also proud to say she is one of our beloved graduates. She graduated from our Master's of Library and Information Science program in 2018. This is just among her many educational and professional achievements, but of course, the one that I'm most excited about as one of our graduates. Well, today, Kiera is going to tell us about challenging librarians to have tough conversations about racism. And I do want to quickly mention that today's webinar is co-sponsored by Drexel Center for the Study of Libraries, Information, and Society, as well as our College of Computing and Informatics Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Council. So, welcome, everybody. I'm going to turn over to Kiera.
Hello, everyone. I hope everyone is doing well. I am in Nashville, Tennessee, so we just got a lot of snow, a lot of ice. Just really quick, a little bit about me. I have, even though I recently graduated the last few years from Drexel, also have a master's in English education. I hold a JD. So I've been in the education system for about 17 years now. So I have a really diverse background. I used to teach African American studies. I created different courses on a collegiate level, taught as a college professor in the political science departments of a college, liberal studies. So I have a pretty unique background. So I'm going to start off. I'm a teacher first. So we're going to have a lot of interaction. The title of this is Challenging Libraries to Hold Difficult Conversations About Racism. And the very first thing that I want to do, I want you all to follow along. Excuse me, one second. I want you all to follow along as I play Lift Every Voice and Sing. Give me one second. I'll put the PDF in the chat box and I'm going to let the song play. It's about 3.5, 4 minutes long. And let's take a moment to listen to the words.
Thank you.
So as we listen to this song, I wanted you all to follow the words. And I wanted you, well, I want you later on to conduct your own research to understand this song and why it needs to be taught and learned. Activist James Weldon Johnson wrote the words of Lift Every Voice and Sing as a poem to highlight the endurance, the freedom, the suffering, and the joy of African-American people. His brother, John, actually set the music for it later on. This song highlights their painful path and discusses the way they have struggled for the betterment of being just an African-American person. And this was many, many years ago. Many still do not even realize that those that are just mere 50, 60 years old are still searching for their identity and trying their best to believe that change is coming. And you think now that in 2021, there is still an overwhelming percent of this, this conversation is for librarians, but there's 80% of white librarians. And this percent should make you go, I don't know if you all remember Arsenio Hall, but it should make you go, hmm. The title of this webinar is Challenging Librarians to Have Tough Conversations About Racism. And although that's the title, it's not exactly what I'm going to do. When I think of the term challenge, it makes me think of putting a contest together, or it makes me feel as if I'm demanding you to do something, and that's not my task. I don't know if you all remember the Nickelodeon show Double Dare or even Fear Factor. I am not here to invite you to join my team, to advocate for racism. What I'm asking you all to do is to become open-minded and make your own decision. We all know that race is a social construct. We all know that racism is something that is wrong, and that we as people, we control this. We judge people before we even take the moment to get to know them. I've seen this at libraries, as an educator, a college professor, I'm also a lawyer. I've seen this at educational institutions, at so many different institutions, and I have been that person that was judged just because of my skin color. So I'm not going to challenge you or anyone to discuss racism. I'm going to share facts with you. I'm going to share stories. My students have always told me that I'm notorious for sharing a story and having a story for everything. I'm not going to focus on trying to demand or convince you to see that racism is real, because as librarians, you have access to every single resource. And if you don't have the power, guess what? You could phone a friend. And you have the skill set from school to research it. The same way we apply, or you apply, the energy to other things that might not be so important right now, you can use that same energy to decide yourself to take action, because each of us know what is right from wrong. So here's a story for you. One game that I will never, ever play with kids anymore is Uno. I swear. Let me cut this off for a moment. I swear I hate playing game. I hate playing Uno with kids, because there are so many rules to this game. And each time I have played with my son and his friends, they always make up rules. And it's always an exception to an exception to an exception. So when we would start the games, we already had the rules established. But when one of them started to lose, oh my gosh, additional rules and exceptions were always made. They get it back to Arsenio Hall, things that make you go, we've already established these rules, but guess what? They're making up more rules. So a few Thanksgivings ago, when I last played Uno with my son and his friends, I found myself challenging them to be fair. But jokingly, I knew better than that. And it was then that I told them, and I promised myself, that I would never go to battle with anyone in an Uno game. And the same way that I would never do that in an Uno game, I don't plan to do that as I advocate for people of color and justice, and for individuals to be able to just be themselves, and systematic racism, which we know is there. I promised myself that I'm not here to challenge anyone. I would not challenge you to be fair. I will not try to find ways to entice you or anyone, but I will ask that, again, you take a moment or two or many to just do your homework and be open-minded. We all know what fair is. Think of that one time you saw injustice. Take a moment, think about it. That one time that you saw injustice. Rhetorical question. What did you do? Did you stand up, or were you that person that sat down and kept your mouth closed? Whether you advocated or not, you knew right from wrong. Some are just seeing the injustice after last year's many events. From George Floyd to the disproportionate amount of people dying due to COVID, to the many that are impoverished. We are seeing inequality, yet many close their eyes and put it to the back of their minds because it does not concern them. Many of us, we can't do that. I can't walk away from teaching my 18-year-old Black 6'2" son what to do if he's accosted by a police officer. I cannot walk away from sitting with him in front of the television or reading about Albert Wilson or taking moments to read pieces by James Baldwin or Toni Morrison that are still relevant in 2021. We all have this moral compass that either we put to use, or for some, they put it to the side because, just like that game of Uno that I just talked about, they can make exceptions because of who they are, and they're only concerned about winning. So stories such as the ones that I'm going to share with you in just a moment. I have four stories that I'm going to share with you from four different young people. They're real patrons, and they're sharing their experiences with you. I want you to remember that our libraries are filled with 80%+ of white librarians. Our patrons are judged, and many do not feel heard or seen because those that are serving as librarians, they have their moral compasses on empty. They are empty because, like many in the mainstream, they don't have to live with these targets on their back. So while I am in love with a good debate, I'm a lawyer, there are many times that these stories that I'm about to play for you should be enough for you to say, hey, let me learn, because not only am I a librarian, but as I know, race is a social construct, and I'm no different from those that I serve. I have the knowledge and the resources to help people. I have the wisdom to know right from wrong and the moral compass that I can use for good. And of course, if you don't have access to information, I said it before, you can always phone a friend. So here are a few stories from real people that I want to share with you.
I want to be successful when I grow up. I'm in elementary school now. I need to see people that look like me in our library. I want to see Black Superwoman and men. I need this. Is this too hard?
So remember, we're actively listening because this is an area that many struggle with. Hear them. We have three more. Listen to them and think about that one time that you either advocated or you walked away.
I want to be seen in my local library. I want to see books by Asian authors, Indian authors, and characters that represent more than our mainstream society. Is this hard?
She wants to see diverse books.
Let's chat. I want to walk into a library without the nagging white librarian following me. I want to be able to receive the same respect that the older white couples receive. I'm a single dad. We come to the library often because I do not have Wi-Fi at home. I cannot afford it because I did have hard times. I'm not okay. Drugs, like they probably think. My wife died. I'm raising three kids alone, and as a Black man, it's not always easy in this neighborhood. I want my kids to see themselves around this place. Why don't they have programs or books or authors that my kids can relate to? Do they even like working here? Because anytime we ask questions, they seem annoyed. This is pre-COVID and now. Do you think we can address this issue to help not just my family, but others who are experiencing the same attitude?
Actively listen.
I need to be seen. I've grown frustrated walking in the doors of my own library. Every single one of the librarians stare at me. I speak, and they almost seem to be scared to speak back. I'm tall, I'm Latino, and I wear dark colors, but I'm here to read and use the internet. I wonder if they know how this makes me feel. I wonder if they know that just because I wear my black jacket with a hood, that it doesn't mean I'm a gang member. I heard them call me that one day. Will you ever see me or care to see me, white librarian?
And these are true stories. So I want you all to think about that. So what is needed? And obviously a wake-up call and a history lesson. And guess what? You're librarians, most of you all. So you have the resources right there at your fingertips. So I share with you at the beginning, I love stories. My students tell me all the time, you have a story for everything. And I honestly do. So I'm going to take you on a timeline journey of my mom's life. So my mom was born August 21st, 1959. 6 months after she was born on February 1st, 1960, four African-American college students in Greensboro, North Carolina, refused to leave the Woolworth's whites-only lunch counter without being served. These four men were Ezell Blair Jr., David Richmond, Franklin McCain, and Joseph McNeil. They were inspired by the nonviolent protests of Gandhi. The Greensboro sit-in is what they call it. And lucky for me, later on, that became my alma mater. And it was not until I attended college at North Carolina A&T State University that I learned of this. My libraries failed me. My teachers failed me. The school system failed me. And had I not attended North Carolina A&T State University in the 1990s, I probably would not have learned of this along with all of the other things that I've learned. So let's go back 4 years before my mom was born so we can see what she was born into. On August 28th, 1955, Emmett Till, a 14-year-old Chicago young boy, was brutally murdered in Mississippi for allegedly flirting with a white woman. His murderers are acquitted. And the case brought intentional attention to the civil rights movement from Jet Magazine to everything. A photo of Till's body, his beaten body, at his open casket was shown. Get this, in 2017, we learned that this was untrue. Carolyn Bryant Donham spoke to Timothy Tyson, a Duke University professor, and this was possibly the only interview that she had ever done. And she shared that everything she said was untrue. This is not the only incident like this that has happened. And as a mom to a now 18-year-old son who is headed to college, I remind him of cases like this all of the time. From Albert Wilson, to Sam Cooke, to Purvis Payne, and we can do our own due diligence to research more, but we know that this is nothing but racism. So why should I challenge you or anyone to speak up about the truth? So the summer 2020, we know, was pretty intense for many because many people were finally woke. And while I thought that it gave me hope in all reality, it really didn't. I felt joyful at that time that things were coming to surface. But there were so many times that I felt, and I still feel like this is just a trend. Speaking up and being a social activist or calling out that Uno player that's making up rules, that's justice. George Floyd was murdered, and it was something that no one that watched it could refute. I sat with my son, and we watched that 8 minutes and 46 seconds at least two times. We watched all the memorials and tears fell down my face. They fell long, they fell hard. I start heavy crying. I sit and watch my teenage son shed tears, listening to the many social activists and family members of George Floyd. And I made him watch the videos. I made him sit down and watch the memorials because I need him to be aware that there are people out there who make up Uno game rules, even when the box has the clear cut directions and cheating does not occur until they start losing. We also talked about Andrew Goodman, James Chaney, Michael Swarner, who were civil rights activists in Mississippi working to help out voter registrators who were killed by a group of white supremacists as well on June 21st, 1964. Again, a couple of years after my mom was born. To me, even though I was not born yet, this was no different, George Floyd from 1963, 4 years after my mom was born. On the day of September 15th, 1963, there were four young people in Birmingham, Alabama that the KKK bombed. 14-year-old Addie Mae Collins, 11-year-old Carol Denise McNair, 14-year-old Cynthia Wesley, and 14-year-old Carol Robertson. It took more than 10 years for anyone to be held accountable for these murders. June 12, 1963, just a few months earlier, Medgar Evers was assassinated in front of his house by white supremacist Brian De La Beckwin, and it only took 30 years for him to be convicted. So why should I challenge you or anyone to speak up about the truth? Wrong is wrong. Wrong is wrong, right? We all have batteries in our moral compass. So, whoa, as I think about this, my mom has really been around for a lot of stuff, and to think she's the baby out of 10 kids. My grandmother was born June 12, 1916. And from 1955 to 1968, my mom was only 9 years old. There were 41 civil rights martyrs killed in violent attacks. You know how easy it is for me to gain this information as a librarian? Just as easy it is for you. This is something that you can do too. Over the course of my mom's lifespan, advocating for equality and justice has been a theme. And unfortunately, while change is going to eventually come, as Sam Cooke says, it definitely will not come if people are closed-minded. With their lips closed, we have to do better. So I'm gonna take a moment to listen to Sam Cooke, because in reality, a change will eventually come.
It's been a long, time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there. Beyond the sky, it's been a long, time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long, time coming, but I know gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. And I say, brother, help me, please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Oh, there've been times that I thought I could last for long, but now I think I'm able. But I know a change gon' come. Oh, yes it will.
So as we think about making a quest to change, I continue to think about the timeline of my mom. If I have to continue to live in the shadows of her and so many other people of color who have just never had a break, such people who don't have the luxury of being able to keep racism out of their household. Because if they're like me, I have to pray for, this is my son right here, my 6'2" black son. I have to share with him, even though his mom, that's me, is a lawyer, his dad is a cop, I have to share with him what to do if a cop ever accosts him. So people who require challenging, I don't feel as if I should have to challenge you to do something that's right. I have to always remind him of things that many can just put to the back burner until they're ready to share, because their kids or their family members, they're just not ready. We don't have that break. They also don't have to be reminded of hashtags, saying their names, or praying that their child does not become a hashtag, even though his mom, his dad, they're educated. Can you imagine those that don't have educated parents? They don't have to worry about hashtags. Walter Wallace Jr., Jonathan Price, George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, Daniel Prude, Jason Washington, Antoine Rose, Khalif Browder, Susie Jackson, Myra Thompson, George Floyd, Ezeal Ford, David Joseph, Bradley Blackshear, Sterling Higgins, Byron Williams, Dominique Clayton, Damian Grimes, Michael McIntyre. The list continues. Eric Garner, Victor White III, Jordan Davis, Kamani Gray, Oscar Grant, Anthony Dwayne Lee, Sean Bell, Kayla Moore, so while I hope that you took something from this, I still feel a bit apprehensive about what many are still jumping on and off the bandwagon just because they think it's a trend. But this is not an option for me. It's not an option for many of us. I wake up, I go to sleep, I go out with black skin. And I just hope that you don't need to be enticed, to be challenged, to have the daily conversations that many of us have to have. The conversation that makes many of us sick to our stomachs as we have to continue climbing these barriers and hosting such webinars to remind people of all professions to see us. If we take the names from just the time that my mom was born, maybe then you would be more empathetic and not need to be challenged to have such conversations. Remember, as librarians, you are the gatekeeper to knowledge. Anything that you need, that you want is at your fingertip. And although it might make you a bit squirmish, it might go against what your friends and your family discuss at the dinner table, we do not know. We all do know what is right. And we all do not need a list of rules to know what's right, or videos that last for 8 minutes and 46 seconds to show us that we need to step up and be a part of that much needed change. So as I close, I have a few rhetorical questions for you all. What can you do to ensure your patrons have a space to feel empowered? What can you do to ensure you are making appropriate changes needed to help our libraries? What can you do to remind your colleagues about the need to make necessary changes to help all of our patrons, particularly those of color? And what can you do to genuinely check on your colleagues of color?
We let it destroy everybody.
I thank you all. So I open up the floor for questions, and I see that some of you all said that you couldn't hear my voice over Sam Cooke. What I shared was I shared the reason why Sam Cooke felt compelled to write the song. He felt compelled after an encounter with the police. So if you take a moment just to look it up, you will understand. You'll even see how he died. You'll see how he died. You'll also see his purpose for writing. A change is going to come. So any questions, any comments?
Yeah, can I go first really quick?
Absolutely.
Hi, Kiara. I just loved your presentation. I work for the Free Library of Philadelphia, particularly in an branch in North Philly, which is Black and brown primarily. And been in the library system since 99, but started out in LA. I don't want to make it too long. But long story short, this was just like everything to me, because it just solidifies and affirms what I went through in this system, which is full of racism. Even the class that I take lately, I've been put in the class with Dr. Denise. And sometimes, you know, I'd be like really irked. Some of the people that I'm dealing with when we go in little groups, I'd be really, really irked. And it's sometimes I don't want to make people feel jaded, like, because you're in school to be a librarian. But it's some BS going on. It's a lot of BS. But I say that all to say I've affirmed since last year that I'm going to speak my truth, whatever, right? I do not want to be like a white librarian, period, right? I was a teenage mother, so when those Black and brown kids come into here pre-COVID, they can look up to somebody like me, right? They can know that whatever your circumstances were, that you could be whatever you want to be, and it doesn't matter. I know it's hard to when white people are following you or whatever, but you are above them. You're amazing. You know what I mean? I'm just getting so emotional thinking about this, but I just, again, want to thank you for this. And to my white colleagues, because I know some of the behaviors that have happened in the past, especially down Central, because I've seen it for my own eyes. Y'all got to do work. Y'all got to do a lot of serious internal work, because the world is going to change. And if you think this oppression is going to continue, then I mean, I really feel sorry for you. I really, really do. But again, I just want to thank you for this presentation. And like I said, again, I'm going to affirm myself, people that look like me, all day, every day, till I take my last breath. And if you got a problem with it, sorry, not sorry. So yeah.
Thank you for sharing. Thank you for sharing. I share a lot of your sentiments just by one of my great mentors. When I first was in library school, I lived over in Germany, and she was a white woman, and I love her still to death. She's over, I think she's in Belgium now, but I remember having a conversation with her. And when I walk into the library, I tell her, I don't see me. And I share with her a story that many of you all may be able to relate with, especially my Black females. My dad never, ever, ever purchased me a white baby doll. And in the 80s, I never understood that. And I shared this with her, and she just thought about it for a moment. But everything that we conversed about, she always took the time to be open-minded. And I saw the change that she made. I don't know if she's up here. I don't know. Normally I send her things that I do, but she has always been very open-minded. And that's one of the very few people that have mentored me, of course, Professor Denise, you know, that are typically, you know, white women and white men that are willing to be open-minded. She didn't fight with me about it. Huh, well, why? When I explained to her, I guess my dad understood the need for me to see me. Because during that time, there were no books about me. And even when you walk into so many libraries now in 2021, we'll say 2019, 2020, post-pandemic, there were hardly any books by authors that look like me. However, there are many authors that look like me. You see programs, no programs with people of color. And why is that? And my personal opinion is that many librarians are lazy. They don't want to take the time to network. I can give you stories just over the last few weeks of people that are reaching out to me. Hey, can you do this? Can you do this? Can you do this? And they want to use you and milk you instead of taking the time to really get to know you and work together. And this is not a trend. This is our life. Like I said before, I can't erase my Black skin tomorrow. Our little babies, our little young people that you heard speak, they can't. They can't change their skin color. They need to see people that respect them for being who they are.
Thank you so much. I'm sorry. I didn't see a hand raise function. My name is Felina Hand. I'm a community initiative specialist with the Free Library of Philadelphia. And I work closely with librarians as a community engagement specialist, making connections with community partners and our friends of the Free Library and patrons. And I want to thank you first and foremost for this presentation. And I want to piggyback off of what you just said, nor do we want to erase our Black and brown skin. We love the skin that we are in. We love who we are. And we embrace that. And we want people to respect that. And I think a lot of it, when people are resistant, or white people who are resistant, is that they feel like it's an attack when we are trying to lift ourselves up. And if they look at the bigger picture, and if they look at the history of the country we all live in, and they see the facts, which they can find, as you stated, as librarians, this is not an attack. This is us seeking justice from hundreds of years of intimidation and racism. And I hope to challenge my colleagues that are on this line with the Free Library of Philadelphia to continue to have these conversations and put your ego to the side and really look at the big picture. If you don't care about the community you serve, you should move on, because people see the work that you do, and they see the work that you're not doing. And I hope that my organization, who appears to be making strides in diversity and inclusion, will continue to do so in a straightforward way. So I want to challenge my colleagues, my white colleagues who are on the call, to continue to have these conversations and be upfront about your, if you're genuine or not. Some people just will not get it, unfortunately. I also want to speak to the materials management section of the books that we have in our library. There has to be more people involved in making selection of the books. Instead of stereotypical books, get some ideas from your staff colleagues about what the books you can have. You know, instead of going to an outside agency or a consultant, start there. But thank you so very much for this presentation, and I appreciate you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Ann. I see Barbara.
Yes, thank you. And I did put this in chat as well. So I'm a collection strategist librarian. I buy books and journals and all that. And it can be difficult to identify books written by BIPOC authors. And what are your thoughts about asking vendors such as Gobi to indicate the race of the authors if those authors choose to identify their race?
So please don't take this the wrong way, but I know, again, as librarians, we have resources. So if you even do something as small as Google their names, you'll be able to see the race of the particular authors. And I know American Library Association, I sit on the YALSA task force, but I also sit on the graphic novels this year. I sat on amazing audiobooks the last 2 years. But when you, we're always publishing, YALSA's always publishing material from, you know, material from various authors, and just ALA as a whole, that's a really good resource to go to. But I think just it kind of goes back, and please do not take this the wrong way, it kind of goes back to us doing our due diligence to take a moment to look them up.
And I would say, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
I'm not buying young adult. I'm buying nonfiction for adults. So books in chemistry, biology, physics, psychology as well. So I do look up authors, some of who you can determine their race, some you can't. So it's just a thought I've had as a way of promoting people who choose to identify. I'm not saying it's the only way, but there's a lot of small presses that aren't even in these big vendors, these big jobbers. And so that's a block as well to purchasing from small presses. So it's just an idea I've had. And I wondered your thoughts. So it sounds like you're against it, and that's
No. Yeah. I see a comment from Victoria, and Victoria gives a very good solution. I don't have the response to it, but she says might there be a difference between asking publishers to tell us authors' race versus asking publishers, can you recommend titles from your backlist that have been written by BIPOC authors? So it may just be your wording. I didn't think about that. Thank you, Victoria.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think part of it is not everyone chooses to identify their race. Not everyone chooses to identify their sexual orientation, their gender, and all that, their disability status. So yeah, just trying to get information out there to us who are buying, who are trying to identify. So titles that are published by people of various diversities. Thank you.
You're welcome. And I know that there's a person that a group that I follow on Twitter, Disrupt Text. Her first name, I think it's Kim. I can't remember her name, but they always are introducing nonfiction, fiction books by people of color. So it's Disrupt Text. I know that's the hashtag on Twitter, but I can't remember her Twitter name. I do follow her, but I can't remember.
We have several questions.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if you're able to catch them all, Kara, but there are several questions in the chat. Let's see, the first one was from, backing up, from Arjun. He said, really intriguing session, given the fact that each day brings new challenges. How can librarians go about initiating efforts for constructive narrative toward enhanced social cultural equity? Tough question.
Say it one more time. I'm sorry. I think I cut out.
Oh, sure. Given the fact that each day brings new challenges, how can librarians go about initiating efforts for constructive narrative toward enhanced sociocultural equity? I think he's asking, with all the challenges in the news, what kind of practical steps can we take toward increasing equity in library structures?
I think just working on yourself. I'm really big on self-reflection in all aspects. So I think just working to learn yourself. I always challenge myself to do something different all the time. So I've stepped out of my comfort I love audiobooks. And now, for example, I'm reading graphic novels. You know, so just taking the time to pick up something that you ordinarily wouldn't pick up, something that may make you squeamish. Maybe pick up, you know, ask someone, do a book chat with just a couple of friends. The piece that I love to start with every time I do a DEI session, I always start off with Recitatif. I'm gonna put it in the box by Toni Morrison. It's her only short story. And you could actually Google it and find a PDF for it. But I always start that off. And when I read this with groups that I work with, we always challenge our implicit biases. And that's the first way to start. You know, we all have those biases. No one can say they don't. I do, you do, every last person up here has, you know, their own particular biases, but take the moment to address them yourselves and to reflect, to become a better person. So every day you get up and do something different. And it doesn't mean that you have to spend hours on end trying to research something, but take the time to learn something. One of the things, I was a director of a library recently. I resigned. It was a horrible position. But I remember I had to have a impromptu implicit bias training with one of my colleagues. She saw a Black man and a Black man scared her. And so I challenge people to, you see someone that might make you uncomfortable, go and have a conversation with them. And of course, COVID, it kind of prevents you from doing things like that now. But if you are in a library, you have masks on, you know, go and just speak to them. Ask them something simple. How has your day been? Take a moment to go up to someone that you ordinarily would not talk to. Many of us don't do that. And it's almost like that kind of common sense, and I hate to use this word, but it's like the elevator speeches. You know, we were taught to have elevator speeches. You're in an elevator with someone. How are you today? Oh, very well. But you have to actively listen. And I've noticed that many people, many mainstream people, many white librarians that I've come into contact with, they talk over you. Stop talking and just listen. Just how are you? Get to know them. Don't go out and judge them because, oh, wow, they look scary. Because the scariest person is probably the sweetest person. I showed you all the picture of my son. He was on a corner of a Chicago street. We were touring Chicago. And if I show you a picture of how he looks on a daily basis with our little white poodle pug dog, he looks completely different. But I should not have to convince you all to see my son as a person. This is something that you should want to do. So challenge your own biases. Start off with reading Recitatif. And every day, I hate to say this, but become braver and go out and learn something that you didn't learn before, that you don't know. Another thing, I have braids. I used to have locks. People call them dreads. I had them for about 10 years. And I tell this story all the time. I took a solo cruise. And this woman, she was drunk. She was a white woman on a cruise. She was drunk. We were in the bathroom washing our hands. And she was really drunk. And she said, your hair. You know, I've always seen people with your hair. Can I touch it? Now, some people, that's a no-go for. Can you touch my hair? Can you touch my locks? No. But for me, absolutely. So she's actually running her fingers through my hair. I let her. And she said, do you wash them? And that was a conversation, something that we were able to converse about. But take the time to get to know someone. Don't make assumptions. So I hope I answered that question.
Definitely. Marilee suggests also check out the hashtag Own Voices.
Yes.
Two people seconded that one. Let's see. Ingram apparently has Own Voices selection list. I didn't know that one. Amy suggests buying Outside the Jobbers.
What's the question?
Oh, I'm just reading through comments.
Can we hear from Mario? He's had his hand up for a while.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't see you, Mario.
Hey, no worries. Thank you so much for having me. My name is Mario. I'm a community college librarian in Los Angeles. And let me tell you that even in LA, there is a lot of inequity and disparities even in a community college library. And so what I would love to tell white librarians, or just, you know, librarians with privilege, and or just, you know, library workers who want to help change the culture so that we can create like more equitable realities for our communities. You know, yes, internal work is important, and especially for the people who don't think they're straight up racist, because I feel like the issue is the people who think they're liberal, who think they're, you know, kind to Black and brown people, but they don't actually do anything. So I feel like action-oriented strategies are very important, not only personally, but structurally, like in your department or your institution, because otherwise, how are we really creating change that's going to last? For example, my community college library didn't have any books by Audre Lorde. And when I noticed this, I had to obviously recommend them. And the librarian who does the collection development, she kind of took it personally. And I'm like, this is not something that you should be taking personally, first of all, because it shouldn't be just one librarian who's buying all the books, right? And you should be open and practice, you know, democratic practices to like hear from not only from your team, but also from your community as to like what kind of books you should be buying. Ideally, of course, you know, we should be hiring more library workers of color. And ideally those people would have more cultural competencies and intelligences to be able to help us, you know, fill those representational needs. So it's about thinking of what really do we mean by equity, by inclusivity, by representation, right? And there's many battles or areas that you can tackle this. So I'm trying to bring it back to like systemic changes. For example, in my community college library, there was a rule, a policy that a student from another sister college couldn't check out a reserve book unless they were taking a class from that specific college. And to me, that's a silly rule, because a student couldn't literally check out a textbook that they needed just because they weren't taking a class at that particular college. So this is a systemic thing that for me is obviously inequitable. And obviously I had to like, you know, make some noise so that the people who have the power to change this policy can change it, but also culturally, right? We need to change the cultures of our libraries. For example, my library is still the type of library that as soon as you walk in, people are shushing you. That is not a welcoming environment, but somehow that culture has stayed in my library because of the whiteness that has lasted for so long. So that's kind of difficult to change, right? But also in my campus now, we're talking about you know, the sheriff's department and their presence on our campus. So that's another huge battle, right? Because like most of us or half of the campus, right? We don't want the LA sheriff's department to be in our community college, but some faculty might, right? And so there's already disagreement, and then people don't understand why this is a big deal. And it's kind of tiresome for, you know, the people that need to be taught or reminded about these reasons, they don't come to these webinars, you know? So it's really hard because like white people need to share these resources with their other white colleagues, especially the ones who feel like that they don't need it because they feel like they're not racist, right? But I just hope that they don't take it personally, because everybody has racist dispositions because we grew up in this racist country of white supremacists. So like people need to like not take it personally and realize that we all need to collaborate and strategize in order to enact systemic change.
And Mario, I couldn't agree with you more. That's the problem. You know, the problem is many people, they go into, you share something with them and they become defensive. And in order for people to stop becoming defensive, they have to take a moment to self-reflect. They have to take a moment just to listen, actively see, and reflect on themselves. So thank you so much. And I see Kyra's hand. I think I'm saying your name right, Kyra? You're muted.
Sorry, yeah, I was trying to unmute. My name is Kira. I work at a free library. It's okay. If I had a dollar for every time, I wouldn't have to.
Kira, so I understand. I get called some of everything, so okay.
No, it's all good. It's all good. I really want to just piggyback off of like what Mario was saying. Like, I completely agree with that. I think a lot of this starts with yourself, and it also starts with actually like deeply engaging with your community and deeply engaging with the people around you. I can speak for Philadelphia. We have a lot of movements within staff that address some of these issues that we're talking about. And we need to think about how each of us can individually take part in those movements and support people that are shining a light on inequities in our spaces. And beyond just our libraries, there are grassroots movements and systems that are working against this. The first one that comes to mind for me is the Black Philly Radical Collective, and it's a group of different organizations in Philly that talk about, that not just talk about, but like protest and do different types of actions that oppose things like police violence. I think that when we think about police in particular, we always talk, or maybe not always, but we often talk about how we can kind of look through the timeline in history and talk about how policing came directly from folks who were bounty hunters and looking for slaves. And that is like a string of history that has pulled us forth to where we are now with current policing, but we also need to do that for libraries, because libraries were not always for community members as they're defined today. They were not for people of color. They were not for poor people. They were for white people who were educated and had money. And we need to understand that that's our history and combat that all the time. So different thoughts, but I just wanted to put that out there.
Yep. Any more questions or thoughts? I thank you all so much for coming to listen. And I do pray that you all will go back and share with your colleagues. And just pray that they do make the necessary changes that we need to make. Because I truly believe that, you know, librarians, we are the gatekeepers. Like I said, I'm a lawyer, I'm a librarian, I'm an educator. And when I look at just the power that we have as librarians, we have so much power, because we don't just reach one group of people. We reach so many different people. Regardless of what area that we are in as a librarian, we reach so many different people. And it's important for us to channel to channel this energy to helping all people. Because if not, you know, Sam Cooke wrote that song many, many years ago, a change is never going to come. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Kira. This was fantastic. So much to think about. So much change we need to work for. And thank you everyone for participating.